one is the Lee Kong Chian Natural History Museum. And I guess you can wow.
Wow.
Public relations.
Yeah, okay, good afternoon everyone. We are Wow Agency. Today we are so excited to show you our campaign. But before I begin, let me introduce my group members. Kimmy, our director, Christine, assistant director, Don, arts director, Don, media relations director, Jun Hong, arts director, and my name is Han, I'm research director. Our client is Lee Kong Chian Natural History Museum. It's the first and only natural history museum in Singapore. It's a home to 800,000 specimens of animals and plants. The museum located within NUS will be open in December in 2014. We currently have two goals in our mind. First is to increase the number of visitors to the museum. Second is to increase the level of commitment of donors. Before we cover the detail of the campaigns, we need to know who the target audiences are. We identify two target audiences. First is the primary target, NUS community, which includes students and staff. The ratio of students to staff is 4-1, so we try to keep that ratio in our primary research to make it more generalizable. And the common trait between students and staff is that they are both active online users. It means we're going to incorporate some online tactics in our campaign. Our secondary target is for donors. However, most of the information about donor is kept confidential. We cannot assess it, so our primary research will focus on the NUS community. So we surveyed in total 204 respondents with a ratio of 3.25 students to one staff. So what do they know about the museum? Surprisingly, 54% of our respondents have heard of the museum before. However, do not be surprised at the number because they only have a very superficial knowledge about the museum. Most of them know about the location as is the NUS shuttle bus passes by. Some of them know about the dinosaurs. Some of them also know about the Natural History Museum. So the problem here is the low awareness towards the museum. We also asked them about the attitudes towards the museum. What do they think about the museum? However, most of the attitudes, only 5% of the respondents answer. So we found that it's not significant enough. And the reason given is the lack of information towards the museum. So if information is a problem, we give them some information about the museum. And we found that there are two messages that would draw their interest. The first one is the home to more than 800,000 specimens. And the second message is highlight certain exhibits. So we're going to adopt this message to develop our unique selling proposition for the museum. We also asked them about the intentions towards the museum after they read all the information. And we found a very interesting finding such that those who have gone to the RMBR, which is the former museum, is much willing to visit the museum, the new museum, compared to those who have not gone to RMBR. The reason given is the respondents said that, I've been to RMBR and I found the exhibits are very interesting, but so I expect the same thing to happen in a new museum. So it's got so this kind of message we will adopt into develop our big idea. So our unique selling proposition from our attitude findings, we're gonna focus on the exhibits itself of the museums, and the big idea is to bring the museum experience to our target audience from our intention findings, and our slogan is discover how it really is. So it means that by bringing the museum experience towards our target audience, we want our target audience to be surprised by what the museum got to offer, and it translates into two objectives. The first objective is for the NUS community to raise awareness of the museum among 80% of the target audience by February 2015. The next objective is to generate positive perceptions towards the museum among 60% of the NUS community by May 2015, and our behavior objective is to encourage 50% of the target audience to visit the museum at least once by December 2015. The second set objective is for the donors. We want to establish donor relationships according to the Greenwich Relationship Management Scale by December 2015. Now I pass my time to my teammate, Jun Hong, to cover the strategies and tactics.
Hi, so our group has come up with four strategies, as you can see. I'll be covering the first two, while my teammates, Don and Christian, will be covering the third and the fourth. Now, so the first strategy we have here is to publicize Lee Kong Chian National History Museum as an entertainment venue for the NUS community. Now, under this strategy, our first tactic is a pop-up exhibition. Now, you must be wondering what a pop-up exhibition is. Well, it's actually a temporary showcase that will feature selected exhibits from the museum. The aim of our pop-up exhibition is actually to increase awareness and interest of the NES community to the museum by giving them a sneak preview of what to expect in the new museum. It will be held at the Central Forum, and we've actually come up with a sample layout of how it should roughly look like. And why a pop-up exhibition? Now, research has shown that, as Han has mentioned earlier, the research has shown that initial exposure to the exhibits were actually likely to drum up intention to visit, thus increasing visitation rates. So this is why we are doing a pop-up exhibition. Now, we'll also be selling discounted museum tickets during the exhibition. This will act as a call to action for them to visit the museum, and the discount itself will be the incentive for them to buy it. We'll also be giving out freebies at the exhibition, so we'll be giving out brochures and sticky notes. So this is an example of a sticky note. The pictures, as you can see, the one on the left is actually the example of what PolyCats did for the Festival of Biodiversity. They actually held it at VivoCity, if I'm not wrong. And we'll also be, to encourage incentives for people to visit, we'll be trying to get sponsors such as Nestle to come out with a Milo van, and Old Chunky to come down with their food van. Now, teaser posters and banners will also be, this is a sample of our brochure. So this will be the front, and this is the inside where the map and the gallery. Okay. The next thing we'll be doing is the teasers, posters, and banners will be put up during the event itself. Now, this will raise awareness about the opening date of the museum. And similarly, we have 5x3 banners also. They'll be hung around campuses for the same purpose. Now, our second tactic under the first strategy are interactive posters. Now, why do we do interactive posters? We want to use it to increase awareness, to generate positive interest towards the museum. And as you can see, these posters kind of depart from the usual kind of posters you see around in school. And we hope these efforts will actually engage our audience by encouraging them to interact with it. So, for example, we have three mock-ups to show you roughly how it works. So this is the first one. It's a dinosaur footprint decal, and we hope to use the sheer size of it to stimulate the interest and the imagination of our target audience. The second one we have is the 3D crocodile decal. Now, these three effects aim to attract the attention again, and again to give our target audience an immersive experience. And for the third one, we have a larger than life bat standee. Now, we'll be using interesting fun facts to pique the interest of our target audience. So, most of my classmates already know, but for those who don't, bats actually have nipples under their armpits. So, that's something new. So, we also do a cutout, so like, to encourage our target audience to actually interact with our posters. Now, all these advertisements will be strategically located around campus, and they'll be at high traffic locations such as the Central Library walkway, the U-Town walkway, bus stops, and the different school canteens. Now, for tactic three, to tie in with our interactive posters is a social media contest. Now, this poster's interactivity serves another purpose, and we hope that these posters will actually encourage our target audience to take a photo with them and to post it on their social media pages and on perhaps the museum's first Facebook page and with the hashtag #discoverit. Now, the most creative entries will win behind-the-scenes tour of the museum, and this will act as an incentive for people to join our competition. Now, the contest will help propagate our publicity efforts by leveraging on the NES communities, their own social media pages, and as they share the pictures they've taken on social media, the reach of our campaign is further multiplied. Next, we have our Foursquare. We'll be using Foursquare. Why will we be using Foursquare? As you know, the RMBR is the previous museum and shifted location from the science faculty to its current location beside the UCC. So by using Foursquare, we hope to publicize this new location. So when people share, people will find out more about this new location of the museum. Now next, our second strategy is to increase the online media engagement of online platforms between the Lee Kong Chian National History Museum and the NES community. Now, our analysis have actually shown that the Facebook page is actually, they're actually posting stuff there now. And previously it wasn't very active, but now they're actually doing stuff. And given that 90% of our online community are actually social media users, we felt that there was a need for Lee Kong Chian to actually engage with their target audience through these platforms. So the first tactic we have is to refresh the online platforms. And for the Facebook page, we have created a new cover page and a profile picture for the Facebook page. So every month there will be a new cover page, and these cover pages will be drawn from themes that they have in the museum. So these themes will be drawn from the different zones that we have in the museum. Next, similarly, we'll also be we'll be refreshing the profile picture and the cover page for the Twitter. And as mentioned earlier, we'll be introducing the hashtag #discoverit to tie in our campaign with the museum. Now last, we have our website. So it's not as fancy as the previous website we've seen, since, you know, we have no choice, this is a NUS website. So we've redesigned it to reflect a cleaner view, and we want to, the new website layout will reflect new information that are important to attract visitors. They will include links such as planning a visit and a calendar of events and such. And we aim ultimately for this website to be a repository of information for all things related to Lee Kong Chian. So visitors can come and visit. When visitors visit this webpage, they can access all the information they need to find out about the web, about the museum itself. Now, our second tactic under this strategy is to utilize the social media calendar. Now, why do we want to use a social media calendar? Now, we felt that it will help ensure that new content will be updated regularly with a focus on the different themes as well. And we feel that this will keep the page interesting and fresh. And in turn, we hope that this will attract new fans and to keep existing fans interested and engaged. So I shall now hand over to Christine, who will talk about strategy three.
Thank you. So strategy three is to sustain visitorship at the museum after its opening. And we have three tactics for that. The first is to provide tours in the museum. And primarily, we want to provide guided tours in the public gallery, which will give the visitors a more in-depth information, and they will have the opportunity to ask questions and to get specific answers. So we feel that this is a better and more comprehensive museum experience than just reading off information. And this will be conducted on selected days per week and on fixed timings. Then we have the private gallery tour, which will be only for very privileged visitors. This means that they will get behind the scenes of the museum and see the daily operations, as well as maybe see some of the collections that aren't allowed to be exposed to daylight. So we want to make this recognized as a very exclusive tour, so this is only for example, winners of the social media contest and for distinguished guests at, for example, special events. We hope that these tours will create a buzz so that the NUS community will talk about the museum and tours, and it will also show the museum's engagement in its visitors. Then we have the ambassador program, which means that the NUS community can become museum ambassadors. And we will provide training programs for them, so they will be enabled to, or it will enable them to show around visitors and on the guided tours in the museum. The advantages for the museum ambassadors will be that they have free entry at all times to the museum, and we hope to make this an official NUS recognized program, so that can encourage NUS students even more to take part in this. Then we have the ticket proposal. And we made a proposal on tickets, which will, it's mainly to encourage continuous visitorships. As we can see, the more tickets you buy, eventually it will make a whole image. So we hope that people will buy as many tickets as possible. And then we have tactic two, which is to incorporate visit into an academic assignment or module at NUS. So that means that the museum will collaborate with academic departments at NUS and faculties also. So it will be a mandatory visit if you take some of these modules. We want to collaborate especially with the Department of Biological Science and the Department of Geography, because they have especially subjects that are related to biodiversity and history. Some examples of models that could be incorporated in a visit is animal behavior, biodiversity, natural heritage of Singapore, and biophysical environments in Singapore. The good thing about these modules is that they're actually, most of them are Singapore studies, which means that everyone can take them. Also, a survey, the survey that we conducted showed that actually the majority of the NUS community knows about the museum through modules they took. So we thought we would take advantage of this opportunity. And this is a tactic that will ensure visit. So we have tactic three, which is to organize museum events and activities. Our first suggestion is a night at the museum, which means that the museum will provide guided tours at night. So this will typically involve arrival with refreshment, then a guided tour around the museum, and then food and drinks and a movie marathon with documentaries about natural history, and it will end around midnight. And that will be targeted the NUS students and staff. Then we have the picnic and hiking day, which will be, or it will involve a guided tour at the museum as well. And it will be also a guided tour in the Kentridge, on the Kentridge Trail, with a picnic in the Kentridge Park, and lunch and drinks would be provided. So the visitors here would be exposed to the biodiversity in Singapore in more realistic settings, and we thought this could be a fun kind of learning experience as well. This tour would be led by the Tony Cats and also with assistance from the museum ambassadors. These two events would each last approximately 4 hours, and we would charge around $40 for them, so it will also act as a source of fund for the museum. This is good opportunities to target audiences to get to know the museum even better and in different ways, and they would hopefully feel more attached after this and generate positive attitudes, and furthermore it would emphasize the museum as an education and research hub. Now I will give the word to Dawn, who will talk about strategy 4.
Okay, so strategy 4 is about the donors. So we want to actually increase the engagement level between the museum and the donors itself. And as my members have already said earlier, the museum will be opening in December this year. And for our opening ceremony, we aim to kickstart the event with a cocktail reception. And at this cocktail reception, our distinguished guests will be able to walk around the museum so that they can enjoy the exhibits and be the first people to actually have a sneak peek to the museum. Also, we will be inviting the guest of honor, the president, Dr. Tony Tan, and also the director of the Lee Foundation, Dr. Lee, to be there. Following that, we will invite the director of the Lee Kong Chian Natural History Museum to actually give a welcome speech. And after that, we will invite both the guest of honor and the director to officially open the museum. To do that, we will be putting up a timeline display on the wall of the museum, and the director and the guest of honor will be fixing on a photo display onto the wall to signify the grand opening of the museum and the historical milestone that the museum has achieved today. Okay, so after that, we will get our guests to be seated for a banquet dinner. And this banquet dinner will be a 5-course dinner, which will cost approximately about $75. Also, we will be providing a free flow of alcohol and also other drinks throughout the ceremony itself. Okay. During the ceremony, we will also want to keep our guests entertained. So we will be inviting the NUS Symphony down to actually play during the dinner. Also, we have come up with a commemorative video which actually shows the different aspects of the museum and the different challenges and milestones that the museum has undergone to get to where it is today. Okay, so moving on. This is our next tactic. Our next tactic actually involves recognizing the donors for their very generous contributions to the museum. And we will do this by having a donors appreciation program. So under this program, there's actually 4 different levels of giving. The lowest being bronze, followed by silver, gold, and platinum. So the donors will be recognized according to obviously how much they donate. So donors who have donated a significant amount will have their names engraved onto a recognition board. The recognition board will be shaped like a tree to signify the vast biodiversity in Singapore. And also, during the ceremony, opening ceremony itself, we will be presenting appreciation awards to the platinum donors. So they will be getting a replica of the leaf, which would have their names engraved on it during the opening ceremony. Okay, so moving on. We will not forget the rest of the guests because they are also very important to us. So we'll be presenting to them a corporate gift, which is actually a coaster with the different animal prints we can find them in the Lee Kong Chian Natural History Museum. Yeah. Next. So yeah, besides increasing the level of engagement with the donors during the opening ceremony itself, we want to actually extend this interaction with them throughout the campaign and hopefully beyond that too. So to do that, we actually propose to implement an annual thank you appreciation card and also to send out an annual newsletter. Now this newsletter will help to keep the donors updated on what is happening in the museum throughout the year and what's the latest things that are happening. Moving on, I'll now talk about the media strategy that we had. So from my members, you would have known that there are 2 big events that we are having. First, the pop-up exhibition, and secondly, the opening ceremony itself. So for these 2 events, we'll be sending out our press kit to the media, and for the opening ceremony, there will be a pre-event and a post-event press release. So for this press kit, it will be released 1 week prior to the actual event itself, and it will consist of fact sheets, biographies of the key personnel within the museum, and also a write-up on the 6-star exhibits from the museum. This would of course include the dinosaurs and the leathery turtle, which is the only leathery turtle in Singapore. Following that, I'll now talk about the budget of our campaign. We have allocated about $3,000 to the pop-up exhibition. Now, the pop-up exhibition will last over a period of 3 days, and we intend to reach out to at least 3,000 people, and that would result in a cost per engagement of about $1 per person. And this cost will actually cover the cost of transporting the exhibits to the venue, which is at the Central Library, and also the exhibition panels and the other logistics that come along with the exhibition itself. For our interactive advertisements, we will put out 9 advertisements over a period of 3 months, and these 9 advertisements will reach out to at least a minimum of 6,000 people. So the cost per exposure per person is only about 50 cents. Of course, for the opening ceremony, being the most important event, we have actually reserved a bulk of our budget for the opening ceremony. It will cover the cost of the recognition board, the food, the signages, the performances, and everything else that will happen during the opening ceremony itself. Okay, next, to actually evaluate the success of our campaign, we will be having a mid and a post-campaign survey. So this survey will be actually measuring the attitude towards the Kong Chiang Natural History Museum, the level of awareness that the museum has, and they will be conducted in the middle of the campaign, such as after each specific event. So for example, after the pop-up exhibition, we'll send out these surveys and test and see whether there is any increase or any changes in the level of awareness and attitudes. Following that, we will also supplement this measurement tool with a social media monitoring. So what we will be doing is that we will go onto Facebook and we will check the number of likes, see whether there's an increase, and then we will also see the level of engagement. We will also see how many people have retweeted us on the Twitter page, how many people have followed us, and also the use of the hashtag itself. Also, we will be measuring the number of check-ins on Foursquare, and we will definitely have to measure the number of visitors to the website. We will also be monitoring the media, as in traditional media like the newspapers. Now, the Lee Kong Chian Natural History Museum is actually very, very good at this. They have been regularly clipping a lot of media clips, so we feel that this is something that the museum should continue to do. But beyond just quantitatively measuring the number of articles that the museum is being mentioned, we feel that there should be also a content analysis of the articles so that we can measure the tone of the voice, the share of the voice, and also the prominence of the article itself. Furthermore, to measure our behavioral objective, which is to actually to reach out to at least 50% of the NUS community by December 2015, we will be measuring the number of ticket sales. So the targeted ticket sales will be about 36,000 tickets in overall. For the donors, we will be measuring the effectiveness of the donor strategies by using a survey that will follow the Greenwich measurement scale for relationships. So this will help us identify the problem areas with our campaign or the successful areas of our campaign also. Okay, in summary, the aim of our campaign is to discover how it really is. Now, I'm sure there are people within the audience who think about, when they think about Singapore, they're like, Singapore, what diversity is there? So us, we invite you guys to discover how it really is at the Lee Kong Chian Natural History Museum. And with that, we will be showing you our commemorative video that we will be airing during the opening ceremony.
The Lee Kong Chian Natural History Museum had its roots in the old Raffles Museum, but post-independence, the natural history part of the museum was left aside one side, and for a long time, until it was adopted by Singapore University, it was named the Raffles Museum of Biodiversity Research. After a fundraising effort in 2009, once enough funds were raised that we could have a building of our own. I think biodiversity is important in Singapore, so it's important to know what we have lost and what we have now. Well, I love the decongestion natural history museum because it is not only it serves its function as a research institute, but it's so much more than that. So it allows the public to come and learn about the biodiversity that we have. And also it's a very dynamic institution. So we actually love what we do, that's why we love it.
History in NUS. Okay, just, I think one of the discussion sessions we had, you did mention that through social media, we are thinking of approaching some of the more prominent bloggers to blog about the museum. There was a discussion on that, right?
Yeah, I think at the end of the day, because bloggers, they actually do need it's not just you have to give them incentives and everything. So we thought maybe it will be easier if we do without them. We do a photo contest instead.
Okay.
They will time everything. Because bloggers, they're not to engage them. You need to how do I put it? Yeah, you need to pay them essentially, which is
reality is of life.
Yeah. So we found that it was easier if we just do a photo contest and we offer prizes that you can actually offer for free. So which is
I know the presentation is coming up, so suddenly the Facebook post went up. No, like, it's not just coincidence. I think I quite like your strategy one of putting the interactive posters. It'll be placed all around NUS, is it?
Yeah, around NUS.
But I have a comment on your bet. Do you think it's the right way up?
We realized it was the opposite. It's supposed to be hanging. But because if you look at the picture properly, right, it's actually hanging, just that it's hanging upside down to our perspective. As you can see, there's a tree actually. The tree is actually on the other end. Yeah, because we want people to interact with it, so you know we want to do a cutout, so people's face have to be there. I don't think it's easy for them to build.
Yeah, so maybe the bed may not be the best. It's a subject for this case.
But the face wouldn't be right.
No, if you have something, have actually have a hook, hooking up to something on top, like towards the ceiling, right?
So the problem we had with that, initially we wanted to do something like that. Mm. The problem is because if you want to put your face in, then face don't really match because you have to be standing, can't really go on the roof.
I think the brochure is very well designed. I think we're likely to adopt that. And I think we quite like your opening mechanism, very innovative idea.
We thought because since you told us a lot about the struggles of the museum, so we thought something meaningful. So by hanging the current museum picture, it signifies that this is where we come to today, and thought it's a good opening mechanism as well.
Also give a brief snapshot of the museum's history in a graphical way. A corporate gift. Was it something you saw, you designed, or? Because it's largely fossils.
The director is going to speak. She loves voiceover.
Sample.
A sample?
Yeah, you can have other pictures as well.
Okay. Sorry, I just, from my ignorance, what is the runics relationship?
we'll be giving you a detailed plan book which we will actually explain, but the Grunics is actually a series of...
It measures the different relationships and whether or not the relationship is put it simply, whether or not the relationship is good or not good. So there are actually many dimensions that you can measure. For example, the level of satisfaction, whether or not the relationship is an exchange kind of relationship, are there mutual benefits, and the amount of trust between the donors and the museum, for example.
Wow, how do you get that kind of data?
It's a survey, so they answer questions based on that.
Yeah. Maybe you give a questionnaire to your donor.
There's a questionnaire
that no, the donor is supposed to fill up the questionnaire.
I think it's not easy to really measure how well, unless you can see they give you money every year. But then I think this is maybe a short survey, maybe not too long, so it doesn't take up too much of the time. So this thing is actually just quantifying, giving you a figure for how strong the relationship is, rather than just basing it on your gut feel. So this actually gives you a certain number, so you roughly know where you are and how you can improve on that.
So you did mention something about quite a number of media release, right? So you did mention that we should do some analysis?
Yeah.
Qualitative or quantitative?
Content analysis. Yeah, so it's qualitative. Yeah, so I mean, for example, on the blog right now, you guys have a lot of the media clippings, and those are qualitative kind of measurements. So we know that the Kong Chiang Museum is frequently mentioned in the media, but we do not know whether or not it's positively mentioned or not positively mentioned. So there is a need for us to actually go and look through and be like, this article says the Kong Chiang Museum is awesome, like that.
It's just a way of quantifying again the positivity or the negativity. So it gives you a number.
Be trolling the comments. I don't know how you use that.
What you mean is actually you have to go through the comments to see what are the comments.
Is that the intention? I'm not quite sure.
The content analysis is for the traditional media, so it's like the newspapers, the news articles. So you won't have to actually look through the comments because
on print,
on print. Yeah. But for the social media tracking, what we really want to actually look at is whether or not the campaign is effective and successful. And for example, the Facebook, they actually have a Facebook insight. So it's like all the statistics already given to you. You just have to look at the numbers and be like, we are on the upward trend, that's good. But if like a certain month you see, nobody is liking your page, or like suddenly there's a dip, then that will be a signal for us to actually look at that particular month and see where or what has gone wrong within that month itself.
Well, that's purely quantitative, right? Because you won't know whether the comment is positive or negative.
Yes.
I can pose a very controversial question that everybody hate my guts because of my comments, and you got thousands of comments. That's not positive also, right?
Mm. So I think for social media perhaps, maybe I'm not aware of any... But we'll get back to you about that. With regards to qualitative measurement with regards to social media. So we'll get back to that. We'll get back to you on that.
Does Google Alerts track social media mentions at this point in time?
Google and Facebook do track the mentions and stuff, but again, it's not really qualitative, it's just pure numbers. So like if you've been mentioning how many posts this month, and not exactly like what the post itself is talking about.
Okay, thank you very much. We appreciate it.